Brothers and sisters watching us tonight, good evening. Did you have a good day? God is good all the time. One more time. God is good all the time. Thank you for coming yet again. Keep it up and do not plan to miss any of these meetings. I have a few questions for you tonight. Have you come along with someone? Did you visit the alleys, highways, byways, bidding people to come to these meetings? If you did, keep that up. We would like to recognize the participation of our friends in the various downlink sites around the world. In Rwanda, my good friend Peter and the wife Jacqueline, we are glad you are attending and encouraging other people to come. In Namibia, Professor Bisanda and company, please feel welcome and invite many others to come. Madagascar, Uganda, Peter Otim, Pastor Sam Mwebaza, are you there? Please keep on coming and invite other friends to come. And India, that subcontinent, please keep on coming. This is the right place for you to be. We are glad to have you, Mahenge. God bless you. We are excited with your reports and the many miracles that God is bringing our way. A downlink site in the island of Ukerewe in Lake Victoria had 1637 attendees in the first night. What do you say to that? And the crowds are soaring. In Wanuzi, the first night they had 640 watching a small screen. Last night they had 750. What do you say out there? If you are happy, wave your hand. Hallelujah. We are also gratified by the reports from South Africa in Transvaal. We are encouraged with your comments, and please keep on praying for us. Now, may I take this opportunity to call my sister, Mrs. Ruth Eyembe, who serves the Tanzania Union as the Women Ministry Director, to lead us to God's throne room with grace. Shall we all stand as she prays? Sister Eyembe.
Bow down our heads as we pray. Our gracious Father in heaven, tonight we come to you again to praise and worship you. Thank you for this day. Thank you for the privilege you have given to each one of us to be here and listen to the message of salvation. Thank you for Jesus, whom you sent to die for us. Help us, Lord, to love him more and more. Bless the little children and the youth. And when they attempted to do wrong, Father, we ask that you shield them with your mighty hand. This evening, Dr. Jere Patzer is about to speak to us, Lord, about salvation. We ask you, Lord, to bless him and use him in a very mighty way so that he can be a vessel to pass your word to us. And Lord, I ask that you pour your Holy Spirit among us here in Mwanza and to the brethren who are watching us through satellite worldwide. And we ask, Lord, that when you come, we will rejoice in your coming and that we may dwell with you in your heavenly kingdom. This is our humble prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Posa chedwa wai mapakomo ayandika zizindikiro zakwanitsidwa zamwonandeka Yesu yo Yesu akugwera posa chedwa Wai mapakomo ayandikiwa Zizindikiwa za kuanitsidwa Zamwonandeka Yesu yo Ndi zamwonandeka Maso ndi maso zamwona ndekam Pulumu tsion zavona nkope yake Yokongo layo zamwona ndekam Yesu yom Ndi zamwona ndekam Maso ndi maso zamwona ndekainen Pulumu tsion zavona nkope yake Yokongo layo zamwona ndeka Yesu yo Yesu akubwera posa chedwa kuza hatenga onse olungamba kuti akakabe kumwamba zamwona ndeka Yesu yo Yesu akugwera posa chedwa kuza hatenga onse olungamba kuti akakabe kumwambako zamwona ndeka Yesu yo Maso ndi maso zamwona ndeka Pulumu tsion zavona nkope yake Yokongo layo zamwona ndeka Yesu yo Maso ndi maso zamwona ndekainen Pulumu tsion zavona nkope yake Yokongo layo zamwona ndeka Yesu yo Yesu akubwera posa chedwa Wai mapakomo ayandika Tikonzeke kukumana naye Zamwona ndeka Yesu yo Yesu akubwera posa chedwa Wai mapakomo ayandikiwa Tikonzeke kukumana naye Zamwona ndeka Yesu yom Ditsa mwona ndekam Masom di maso Zamwona ndekam Ulu mutsi yom Zawona nkope yakem Yoko ngolayo Zamwona ndekam Yesu yom Ndi zamwona ndekam Maso ndi maso Zamwona ndekainen Bulu mutsi yom Zawona nkope yakem Yoko ngolayo Zamwona ndekam Yesu yo.
Good evening, friends. We are so glad to be here. We have got a special feature this evening. Darren, why don't you tell us a little bit about it?
All right. Tonight, we are very pleased to have a member that you may already be quite familiar with. Each night, we have the Belco Brass, who are joining us here on stage, and you probably already appreciate their music and are familiar with it. Tonight, we're going to have a couple of songs. We'll talk briefly with them to give you some background information, and then we'll have another song. So without further introduction, Belco Brass.
satellite locations could have seen this man's fingers on the piano. It looked like butterflies up and down and up and down.
I'd like to introduce the members of Belco Brass and actually have them introduce themselves and tell us briefly where they're from.
Thank you, Darren. My name is Ivan Belco. I'm from California, from the small city of Turlock, California.
My name is Boris Belco, and I'm from Southern California, a place called Riverside.
My name is Mark Johnson. I am from a little town in Oregon called Hermiston.
My name is Ed Wagner, and I'm from a medium-sized city in California called Fresno.
Thank you, gentlemen. Well, Ivan, why don't you tell us, how was Belco Brass formed? What is that name Belco about?
Thank you, Natalie. I'd be happy to. As youngsters, about the fifth or sixth grade, my brother and I started playing our instruments through grade school, through high school, and into college. We went our separate ways. We got married. We raised a family. They grew up. They left home. And so in the mid-70s, my brother and I got together and said, well, let's start playing again like we used to when we were kids, and we enjoyed it so much. And so we start calling ourselves the Belco Brass because that's our name, and it kind of stuck with us ever since. In the late 70s, we heard Ed Wagner play. We liked his play on the keyboard. We asked him to join us, which he did. In 1990, Mark Johnson joined us in a trio. Incidentally, his father played in a trumpet trio with my brother back in the 50s, so we're happy to have Mark with us.
Thank you very much. We'd like just a second with Ed as well, if you don't mind. Tell us briefly what other opportunities you've had. This is quite an opportunity we all have here with this satellite evangelism. Could be potentially the largest satellite evangelism our church has ever done. Tell us briefly what else you have done as a group.
We have done a lot of traveling. Probably the most memorable traveling we've done is over in the country of Russia, Ukraine, Siberia. We were involved with the Russian Bear Hug Ministry. We had a good time there. We learned a lot of new things, met a lot of new people. In Ukraine, we worked with John Carter. In Moscow, we worked with Mark Finley. We also traveled all over the U.S. in different places, playing for camp meetings. So we've had a lot of different experiences.
And some of those have been with Dr. Jere Patzer also, haven't they?
That was over in Magadan.
Good, neat. Now, we'd like to talk to Mark for a minute. Mark, now think back. Is there a memorable moment here with Belco Brass that really comes to mind that you'd like to share with us?
You know, there are a lot of moments that we've had that have been memorable. But one that sticks out in my mind is... One that sticks out in my mind is a trip that we had to Magadan with Dr. Patzer in 1991. We were getting set up for a meeting. There was a group who'd gone to a prison, and they had taken the pastor, who happened to have a key to a room that we needed to be in to get set up for the meeting. Unfortunately, the deadbolt was locked to that room. We had no way to access the things that we needed to set up the meeting. We had a quick prayer. Everybody in our group joined. We had a prayer. We walked back over to the room, and the door to the room was ajar, and the lock was still locked.
Amazing.
And it was open. And right there, we said a prayer of thanks.
Awesome.
It was very amazing. And we knew that we were blessed, and the blessings were innumerable.
Awesome. Now, is there an email address that we could contact you at? If folks are interested in emailing, something to the group, if they'd like to thank you for your ministry or they'd like to get a hold of your music somehow, I think that we're going to put up an email address, and you'd welcome that. Just in closing here, I'd like to ask Boris to share a few thoughts with us. Boris?
You know, it's amazing to us, and it's thrilling to realize that music can penetrate any language barrier. This is made known to us in the fact that when we played the song Always Cheerful, whether it was in Moscow, whether it was in the Ukraine, or even in Guatemala last year, the people knew the song, they stood up and they sang. If you folks know the song and you want to stand up and sing in your language, the Lord will understand what you're singing. Always cheerful.
Amen. Thank you so much.
Stop.
My songs
redemption grant, oh wondrous grace. Here lift your praise to God above, who saves us on redemption grant. Redemption grant, the grant of peace. Redemption grant, oh wondrous grace. Here lift your praise to God above, who saves us on redemption grant. Oh joyous hour when God to me a vision gave of Calvary. My bones were loose, my soul abound. I sang up on redemption ground. Oh joyous hour when God to me a vision gave of Calvary. My bones were loose, my soul abound. I sang up on redemption ground. Redemption ground, the ground of peace. Redemption ground, oh wondrous grace. Here let your praise to God above, who saves us on redemption ground. Redemption ground, the ground of peace. Redemption ground, oh wondrous grace. Here let your praise to God above, who saves us on redemption ground. Redemption ground, the ground of peace. Redemption ground, oh wondrous grace. Here let your praise to God above, who saves us on redemption ground.
We want now to turn to our theme song. And we are ready to start, Phil. I found the way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Phil.
I found the way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found the way in Jesus. He is my way to heaven. I found the way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found the way in Jesus. He is my way to heaven. No one can stop me now. Nothing can stop me now. No one can stop me now. Since Jesus is my way. I found the way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found the way in Jesus. He is my way to heaven. I found the way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found the way in Jesus. He is my way to heaven. No one can stop me now. Nothing can stop me now. No one can stop me now. Since Jesus is my way.
We'll pick on from there tomorrow night. God bless you.
The way in Jesus. I found the way in Jesus. Wherever you are this evening, I've got to tell you that it can't be a more beautiful evening than it is right here in Mwanza, Tanzania. I want to thank all of you for coming this evening. We've been receiving these exciting reports coming in from all over where you're watching on your downlinks. And I want to welcome you, those of you who are watching, some church, outside, some home, you've honored us by being here this evening. As I've mentioned before, we have a whole battery of translators working behind us. One of the more prevalent areas is in Malawi, where they speak Chichewa. And they would say to us tonight, and I would say to them, Mani Nase. That is greetings, everyone. Again, I want to thank you for being here this evening. I grew up in Washington, D.C. It's the capital of the United States. It's a beautiful city. The Washington Monument, the great statue of Lincoln, the changing of the guards, Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. But there's one building, Washington, D.C., that few tourists, even Americans, take time to visit. It's a very beautiful, stately building called the Library of Congress. Now, as you walk through the doors of that Library of Congress, you enter a large round room, high ceiling, supported by huge pillars. And all along them, there are statements made by great statesmen, presidents, other influential people, written on those pillars. One of those statements, made by the author Tennyson, says this, and I quote, "One God, one law, one element, and one far-off divine event to which the whole creation moves." Now, Tennyson wasn't alone in his theory. Many people sense that we are moving towards some divine event. Many see the events happening around us today and wonder what lies just ahead. Our natural resources are simply being depleted. Waters are polluted. Rainforests are disappearing. Garbage dumps are filling at an alarming rate. We question the stability of our economy. There are strikes. Price of basics has gone up. We've all been a part of rumors, violence, wars, right here in Africa and abroad. And now we are precariously perched at the beginning of a new millennium. How much longer can this old planet Earth go on like this? What is our destiny? What can we expect? Is anything predictable? Where can we look for accurate, reliable answers concerning that future? I want to show you something tonight, something very unique. Do you know that 30% of what is written in the Bible is prophecy, writings about the future? Now, why is that so unique? Well, the writings of Muhammad contain no prophecy. Examine the writings of Buddha. There is no prophecy in the writings of Buddha. There is also no prophecy found in the writings of Confucius. That it contains 30% prophecy is one reason why the Bible is so unique. One of my favorite texts is over here in Acts, 17th chapter and the 26th verse. This is what it says. "And he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on all the face of the earth." You know why I like that? Because it says, when I am here in Africa, that all of us are of one blood. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. Now, last year we were doing a crusade in Guatemala. We have a daughter that we adopted from Guatemala. We knew that we were brothers and sisters with those people in Guatemala because the Bible says so. A couple years ago, we did one down the beautiful island of Papua New Guinea. They have an expression for this. They say if it's a family, if they're brothers and sisters, they say it's one talk. One talk, meaning we all talk the same kind of language. And so the Bible is very clear, my brothers and sisters, that we are all one in Jesus. So whether you're in Nairobi, Kenya tonight, watching in that large church, Lagos, Nigeria, Abidjan, the Ivory Coast, Bluefontaine, South Africa, we are one in Christ. Lusaka, Zambia. Lilongwe, Malawi. Madras, India. Brazo, Romania. Suva, Fiji. Or even clear back home in Walla Walla, Washington. We are one in Christ Jesus. And that text goes on. And it says, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings. Of all of the religious writings, the Bible alone predicts where you and I are headed and describes the events of the future. And that is why it is absolutely necessary that we believe and study it in its entirety as the inspired Word of God. Remember what we said before? If it's not in the Bible, it's not for me. If it's in the Bible, then I've got to believe it. And so in this world, there are many people who talk about God, many who have ideas, theories, a general knowledge about Him. In fact, at least in our country, it's even popular now for politicians to reference God's name to help them gain public popularity and even to become elected. There's an American gospel song. And this is what it says. Everybody talking about heaven ain't necessarily going there. You see, people are generally legitimately ignorant when it comes to the Word of God. But ignorance isn't an excuse. In fact, it can be a serious problem if we do not spend time with the Word of God. You know that. That's why you're here tonight. And God has given us two very special prophetic books in the Bible to help us. To help us understand where we are in this span of time and what will happen way down in the future. One is in the Old Testament. It's the book of Daniel. It is full of end-time prophecies. And the other one is in the New Testament. It's called the book of Revelation. And it, too, contains predictions of our day and the still pending future, making it clear where we are poised in the prophetic time period. In fact, all of the prophecies in the book of Daniel are repeated in the book of Revelation. Tonight we're going to take a look at the prophecies in those two books. Unlike what many people in the world would have us believe, it is not something that you can't understand, my friends. The book is called Revelation, which means the revealing. And when you pick it up and begin reading it, right in the very beginning of that book, God gives you a promise. Listen to what he has to say in Revelation chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is near. You see, God wants us to read it, understand it, exactly where we are and where we're headed in the big scheme of time. In fact, God said, if you'll just take time to read it and you'll listen to what it has to say, he in turn will bless you. Recently, I personally used the book of Revelation as a basis for my devotional life for an entire year. And I can attest to the fact that I was blessed. Tonight, we're going to follow his instruction and see how God's word, step by step, leads us right down to the time in which you and I now live. We're going to take a look at a prophecy. It's in the book of Daniel, chapter 2. Are you ready to go? Let's do it. There was a king by the name of Nebuchadnezzar. He had a dream. However, that ruler could not remember what he had dreamed, and he felt it was extremely important, and indeed it was. You see, God had given him a dream that outlined for us the world's history, especially of Europe and the Middle East, from Nebuchadnezzar's day all the way down to the end of time. Thank God that he shared with us what the future holds. You see, Babylon, the first world empire, was really the greatest. It was the richest and the most influential of all the empires in the then known civilized world. It also had the most powerful king. Now, this leader of men had managed by sheer force to put down his enemies one by one until his kingdom stood as the queen of all the nations. And in the second year of his reign, King Nebuchadnezzar went to bed wondering just how long that kingdom would endure. And he, just like other rulers, wanted to know about the future. That night, God looked down from heaven and chose to entrust this benevolent dictator with a look into the future. And when the king woke up early from his fitful sleep, he was troubled. He had experienced a dream, and he knew that it was something of great importance, but he apparently couldn't remember what it was. Ever have that happen? Sure you have. You've awakened in the morning, had a dream, but couldn't think of it. That's what happened to King Nebuchadnezzar. And the Babylonians placed great importance on dreams. And so the king naturally wanted to know the dream and what it meant. Of course, he had astrologers, magicians, enchanters, sorcerers. Surely they could tell him what it was all about. Despite the early hour, they were summoned to the court. And when they came in and stood before the king, he said to them, Daniel 2, verse 3, I have had a dream, and my spirit is anxious to know the dream. Now, these men were like many who pretend to know what the future tells. They can make a guess at interpreting dreams, but they didn't really know the dream's meaning. They stalled for time. Finally, these men said this in verse 4, O king, live forever. Tell your servants the dream, and we will give the interpretation. But their self-confidence soon vanished as that proud monarch, tired of their stalling, said, in verses 5 and 6, the king answered and said to the Chaldeans, My decision is firm. If you do not make known the dream to me, and its interpretation, you shall be cut in pieces, and your houses shall be made an ash heap. However, if you tell the dream and its interpretation, you shall receive from me gifts, rewards, and great honor. Therefore, tell me the dream and its interpretation. Now again, they tried to get the king to tell them the dream. The king knew by this time that they were frauds. And he threatened them again, and finally they confessed. In Daniel 2, 10 and 11, the Chaldeans answered the king and said, There's not a man on earth who can tell the king's matter. Therefore, no king or lord or ruler have ever asked such a thing of any magician or astrologer or Chaldean. There is no one else who can tell it to the king except the gods whose dwelling is not with flesh. And the Bible says that the king was furious. And he commanded all the wise men to be executed. Now, unfortunately, Daniel and those three Hebrew young men with him were classed among the wise men of that country. Though they were not present with the other wise men when the king demanded an explanation of that dream. Now, when the soldiers came to get Daniel for the execution, he was naturally shocked, but he asked for some time that he might consult the God whose dwelling was not with men and asked for some wisdom to make the dream known to the king. And so we find in verses 12 and 15, the king, out of respect for the honest young man, granted Daniel time to talk to his God, the God of creation. Now, what a responsibility rested upon Daniel's shoulders. Not only was his life and the lives of his three friends at stake, but the lives of all the wise men of Babylon. Daniel returned to his house and explained the situation. And all of them began to plead for mercy from the God of heaven to reveal this mystery so that they might not be executed with the rest of the wise men in Babylon. What a prayer meeting that must have been. Four young Hebrews praying that God would reveal the dream of a heathen king before a fateful deadline. The Bible says that the God of Daniel that very night revealed the secret dream to him in a night vision. The God of heaven did not fail to hear and honor those prayers. And so Daniel blessed the God of heaven and said, verse 23, I thank you and praise you, O God of my fathers. You have given me wisdom and might and have now made known to me what we asked of you. For you have made known to us the king's demand. What excitement there must have been in the hearts of Daniel and those three Hebrew friends. Daniel ran to the chief executioner, Arioch, and you can bet he was in a hurry. As the Bible says there in verse 24, then Daniel went to Arioch, whom the king had appointed to destroy the wise men of Babylon. He went and said to him, do not execute the wise men of Babylon. Take me to the king, and I will interpret his dream for him. As Daniel came into the presence of the king, Nebuchadnezzar asked him if he was able to make known what the king had dreamed, along with the interpretation. The secret which the king had demanded, the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, and the soothsayers, the one that they couldn't declare. Let's take a look at how Daniel replied to the king. You know what I've been tempted to say? Hey, you bet, O king. Oh, buddy, I've got it. You stick with me. Daniel 2:28 wasn't the way he responded. He said, but there is a God in heaven who reveals secrets, and he has made known to the king Nebuchadnezzar what will be in the latter days. Notice, Daniel did not take the credit for his knowledge. He knew that only God could reveal the future. In Isaiah 46:9-10, he had probably knew the concept that's recorded there where it says, for I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times, things that are not yet done. This wisdom came from God, who had taken this occasion to outline the history of the world for over 2,600 years, from King Nebuchadnezzar all the way down to this date, this very night. Now, first, Daniel gives the background of this dream that the king had dreamed. Follow with me there in Daniel 2, verse 29. As for you, O king, thoughts came to your mind while on your bed about what would come to pass after this. And he who reveals secrets has made known to you what will be in the latter days. And Daniel goes on, tells the dream. Daniel 2, verse 31. You, O king, he said, were watching, and behold, a great image, this great image, whose splendor was excellent, stood before you, and its form was awesome. Can't you almost hear the king saying excitedly, right on, Daniel, that's it. That's it. Awesome image, towering above everything. Daniel describes the dream so clearly that Nebuchadnezzar has no doubt that it's that same dream that he had had. In verses 32 and 33, then Daniel continues, this image, his head, was of fine gold, its chest and its arms of silver. Its bellies and its thighs are of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of clay. And it amazed Nebuchadnezzar. He listens as Daniel describes the elements making up the image exactly as he had seen it in his dream just before. The head was bright, shining gold. The chest with the arms was of less lustrous silver. The belly and the thighs were bronze or brass. The legs and the iron of the feet were a mixture of clay and iron. Chapter 2, verse 34 and 35, it goes on. You watched while a stone, said Daniel, was cut out without hands. It struck the image on its feet of iron and clay and broke them into pieces. And then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold were crushed together and became like the chaff from the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away so that no trace could be found. Next, the king must have been startled to see that stone hurtling out of nowhere and coming with such fantastic speed, striking the image at its feet, crushing them, and then violently shattering, pounding the whole image into dust, so fine that the wind removed it without a trace. And the text goes on in verse 35, and the stone that struck the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. Yes, Daniel, the king must have said, a rock was cut out without hands and smashed the image and became a mountain that filled the earth. And that whole dream was exactly as the king had dreamed it. Imagine how amazed Nebuchadnezzar must have been to be told by this noble young man every detail of the dream just the way he had seen it himself. One thing must have been absolutely certain to the king, and that was that no man could have revealed this to Daniel. No man can tell what someone else had dreamed. It could only have come from some divine source. The king may have wondered now what the dream had to do with him. We might have the same thought. Nebuchadnezzar's dream, however, predicted the rise and the fall of key nations of the earth. The kingdoms represented in his dream, clear back then, have in some way or another influenced every nation of the entire world, especially in modern times. In just a few words, God sketched the main course of history from Babylon's time 600 years before Christ, clear down to the climax of Earth's history. And finally, Daniel gets to the heart of the dream in verse 38. Looking straight at the king, Daniel said, O king, you are this head of gold. Babylon was the head. It was a nation of pure gold. And you can just imagine a smile of satisfaction must have crossed the king's face as he heard those words. The military conquest, the architectural splendor of Babylon were unsurpassed. Historians confirm that gold was a fitting symbol to represent the kingdom of Babylon. Gold was lavishly used in embellishing the buildings of Babylon. Notice one historian's description of that great ancient city. This is what he said. He said, situated in the Garden of the East, laid out in a perfect square with a moat or ditch around it, its gates of brass, its hanging gardens rising terrace above terrace, its two royal palaces there, with the whole earth prostrate at her feet. A queen in peerless grandeur stood this city. Fit capital, he went on to say, of the kingdom, which was represented by the golden head. That fabulous hanging garden that was just referenced to Babylon were one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. You know, had Daniel been politically correct right then, trying to make a name for himself in Babylon, he would have stopped the interpretation of the dream right there. But Daniel had a message that God wanted revealed to the whole world, a message not just for his time, but one that would be relevant to the end clear down to Earth's history. So Daniel humbly but boldly declared to the king in the 39th verse, and after you shall arise another kingdom inferior to yours. You see, the king's smile of satisfaction probably began to quickly fade, just as quickly when he heard those words from Daniel. Babylon's proud monarch probably never given a thought to the idea that any other nation would ever rule the world after his. In fact, archaeologists have excavated clay tablets down in the heart of the earth, inscribed with these words by Nebuchadnezzar from his time that said, "The fortifications of Isagila and Babylon I strengthened and established the name of my reign forever." That's what Nebuchadnezzar thought. But the Bible states that that proud Nebuchadnezzar, in verse 30, spoke saying, "Is not this the great Babylon that I have built for a royal dwelling by my mighty power and for the honor of my majesty?" However, God said that another power would arise that would succeed the golden kingdom of Babylon. And Daniel lived to see that fulfillment of prophecy. During the reign of Belshazzar, the arrogant and proud grandson of Nebuchadnezzar, Cyrus the Mede, laid siege to Babylon. And October 13, 539 BC, before Christ, the golden kingdom of Babylon came to an inglorious end. Notice that God had prophesied exactly by whom and how the city would be taken, nearly 200 years before the fall of Babylon. God, through the prophet Isaiah, had said over in Isaiah 45, verse 1, "Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have held, to subdue nations before him and loose the armor of kings, to open before him the double doors so that the gates will not be shut." You see here, God even told by whom it would happen. Cyrus the Mede, 150 years before he was born. Cyrus could not break down those walls as they were too high and too thick. And so he devised another way. History tells us that he diverted the river that ran through the center of the city, and his army would go down the riverbed until they found a way into the city. And someone, through carelessness or treachery or drunkenness, had left the massive inner gates of bronze unguarded and open. And the soldiers of Cyrus entered the city. They killed the king and his nobles as they drank wine from the golden vessels taken by King Nebuchadnezzar when he had captured the city of Jerusalem. He had looted those golden vessels from God's holy temple years before, and Daniel had predicted that after the golden empire of Babylon, another kingdom, inferior to Babylon, but nonetheless represented by the chest and the arms of silver, would come to power. And so the coalition of governments of the Medes and the Persians was certainly inferior to the glorious Babylonian empire before it, but it ruled the Middle East for 200 years. Daniel predicted that kingdom of silver would have its limitations also. He said there in verse 39, "Next, the third kingdom, one of bronze, will rule over the whole earth." Now, did that come to pass? It certainly did. This prediction of the metal image, the bronze belly and the thighs of bronze, was fulfilled when that brilliant young general, you know his name, Alexander the Great, defeated Darius of Persia in the Battle of Arbela in 331 BC, before Christ. The third world empire was Greece. And at the youthful age of just 25 years, young Alexander became ruler over one of the most extensive empires the world had ever known. The Greek historian Arrian, writing about Alexander, said, "I am persuaded that there was no nation, city, nor people where his name did not reach. There seems to me to have been some divine hand," he wrote, "presiding both over his birth and his actions." Divine hand indeed. Fittingly, much of the armor worn by the Greek infantry was made of brass, That was the third medal in Nebuchadnezzar's dream. And Alexander died before his 33rd birthday of a fever. Now, after his death, his empire was weakened and split into several parts until finally on June 22, 168 BC, at the Battle of Pydna, perished the empire of Alexander the Great, 140 years after his death. And that's documented in the history books. And now comes the most terrible of these ancient kingdoms. You heard about it too. You remember that God predicted that there would be four world empires, one right after another. And here's how Daniel described it to the king in verse 40 of chapter 2. And the fourth kingdom shall be as strong as iron. Now, indeed, the iron legs describe well the ruthless, destructive power of that fourth world empire. You see, our Caesars called themselves gods. They demanded the worship and the obedience of all of their citizens. And it was during the time of the Roman rule that two events of great importance to us today took place in this nation. First, you know what it was. Jesus was born in Bethlehem. And it was a Roman governor who made a decree to kill all the male babies who were 2 years old or younger in Bethlehem. Imagine, he had hoped to kill baby Jesus. And then secondly, Jesus was crucified in Judea under Roman authority. It was a Roman governor that allowed Jesus to be condemned to death. And Roman soldiers nailed Jesus to the cross. And a Roman seal was placed over Jesus' tomb to try to keep him in. Now, the pattern of prophecy changed. No single world empire would follow Rome. Verses 41 and 43 of Daniel 2 says this: just as you saw that the feet and the toes were partly baked clay and partly of iron, so this will be a divided kingdom. So the people will be a mixture and will not remain united any more than iron mixes with clay. In other words, the prophet predicted not a fifth world empire would rise, but a division of the iron monarchy of Rome would occur. Rome would be divided into a number of kingdoms. The iron fiber of that giant empire of Rome that had ruled for nearly 600 years totally disintegrated through luxury, political corruption, and moral decay. Rome lost its stability and the strength, becoming an easy prey for the barbaric tribes that began to invade the empire between AD, after Christ, 351, and AD 476. Emperor Augustus was deposed, and Rome was divided into many segments, represented by those feet, those toes of the image, made of iron and made of clay. In the 43rd verse, it says, as you saw iron mixed with ceramic clay, they will mingle with the seed of men, but they will not adhere to one another, just as iron doesn't mix with clay. Now, the barbarian invasions of Rome divided the empire. These divisions, represented by the feet of iron and clay, formed the foundation of the nations located in Europe today. 10 of these tribes, barbaric tribes, follow what the historians say. Read it from the screens with me. Look at it closely. The Alemanni were the Germans. The Burgundians were the Swiss, the Franks the French, the Lombards the Italians, the Saxons the English, the Suevi the Portuguese, the Visigoths the Spanish, the Heruli the Ostrogoth, and the Vandals, which are now extinct, merged with other nations around them. You see, God's proclamation that these kingdoms will never be reunited as a world empire again limits what these nations do. Europe will stay divided they will not ever stay together. Even with all the talk about the European market and a common currency, they are still, to this day, divided. He said that even if they mingle themselves with the seed of men, in other words, they would intermarry royalty. There's a place in Denmark where the family tree of the royal family of Europe is pictured. They're all related. They hoped it would prevent more wars, but it didn't work. They couldn't get along with each other's families. So many of the wars fought in Europe were really big family squabbles. God had predicted that they would not stick together. They tried to put the Roman Empire back together. But this would never last, even as that iron and the clay of the toes would not stick together. Think of the many attempts that have been made to glue the nations of Europe together down through recent history. What happened to these would-be world leaders who tried to unite divided Europe? There was Charlemagne. Remember him from your history? He was defeated. Charles V. What happened? He was defeated. Louis XIV, defeated. Napoleon, defeated. Kaiser Wilhelm, defeated. And Hitler, certainly defeated. An exile on the Isle of Elba, Napoleon, that mighty warrior of France in the early 1800s, had to admit that God was too much for him. God was too much for all of them. God had said, "They shall not cleave one to another." A fitting epitaph for all of these would-be world rulers. However, men are still trying to weld that European countries together today, but they just can't seem to make it stick together. Just as God said, should we be surprised? Well, they may get together, but they can't stick together and stay together. Nebuchadnezzar must have been puzzled by this turn of the prophecy. God foretold the doom of the four great world empires. He predicted that Rome would be succeeded by a number of nations, seven of which are represented in Western Europe today. Some of them are strong, some are weak, but all of them are hopelessly divided. What would happen next? With obvious joy and confidence, Daniel now came to the astounding climax in interpreting the dream of that great metallic image. And he wrote in chapter 2, verse 44 and 45, "In the time of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed, nor will it be left to another people. It will crush all those kingdoms and bring them to an end, but it itself will endure forever." This is the meaning of the vision of that rock cut out of the mountain, not by human hands. Verse 45. A rock that broke the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold to pieces. The great God has shown the king what will take place in the future. The dream is true. The interpretation is trustworthy. Now, the next great event, friends, on the stage of human history will be the second coming of Jesus Christ and the establishment of his kingdom, represented by that stone cut out without hands. His kingdom will be founded not by the hands of men, but by the mighty hand of God, a kingdom that will fill the whole earth. And then will be fulfilled the prophecy of Revelation 11:15. "The kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord, and he shall reign forever and ever." Hallelujah. Amen. Notice the last events covered by this amazing prophecy in the book of Daniel. It's Jesus' second coming. The nations of the world will come to an end. God will set up his kingdom. This kingdom will last forever. And Jesus will be anointed as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Ah, he comes to earth to reign over an everlasting kingdom. When Daniel finished telling the king his sensational vision, God's astounding interpretation, King Nebuchadnezzar rose from his throne, humbly prostrated himself before Daniel in honor of Daniel's great God in heaven, whose wisdom and power had been so impressively demonstrated. And the king said to Daniel, 47, surely your God is the God of gods and the Lord of kings and a revealer of mysteries. Truly, friends, Daniel's God is a God. He's a God I want to be my God, the God who holds a future in his hands. By this giant metal image seen by Nebuchadnezzar in his dream, 6 centuries before the birth of Christ, God unveiled the mysteries of the centuries to come. Yes, friend, tonight, the dream is certain. The interpretation is sure. The journey on this old earth is almost over. The next great event is Christ coming in the clouds to set up his everlasting kingdom. The kingdoms represented by the gold, the silver, the brass, the iron have all passed into history. And the next glorious event is our Lord's soon coming. He has planned a beautiful tomorrow that has been made possible through the blood-stained cross on Calvary. It's only a short time till all these things are fulfilled. Right now, God is making up his kingdom and those who are going to be a part of that kingdom. And we can be certain that we'll be part of it if we will only, by faith, do what the thief on the cross did as he hung between heaven and earth next to Jesus. He couldn't get any closer to Jesus, but he knew that he was a sinner and that he needed to be saved from those sins that he had committed. So he looked over at the Savior of the world and saw that blood running down his face from those thorn-pierced hands in his brow, and his heart was touched. And he confessed his sins, and he cried out in Luke 23:42, Lord, remember me when you come in your kingdom. And Jesus, bless his name, gave him the assurance that he would be with him in that kingdom. Now, you too, friends, can pray that prayer, receive that same assurance that you will be with Christ in his kingdom, in that soon to be set up kingdom on this earth. And then you will hear from Christ's lips this invitation at his return, Matthew 25:34, come you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you. Listen tonight as Walter Ortiz sings to us.
Faith looks up to thee. here you have it. This great prophecy, this great timeline of world history. And right at the center, you have Jesus Christ. That's the way it is for every true doctrine in this book, you know. If it doesn't bring us closer to Him, then it's of no eternal value. And so this world is not in the hands of human beings. It's in the hands of God. We can face the future with great confidence because soon Jesus Christ will come. That rock cut out without hands will smite that image. The kingdoms of the earth are all going to crumble, and God is going to usher in His eternal, His everlasting, His wonderful kingdom. You can have confidence in this God, friends. You can trust in this God. You can rest securely in His hands. And He's calling you today. He's inviting you to come today. He's appealing to your heart right now. Wouldn't you like to say yes? Yes, Lord, I will completely trust You. You have been able to rule the entire universe. I can trust my life with You. I surrender my life to You right now as we pray. Friends, tonight, if you'd like to say yes to that appeal, I invite you to stand to your feet all over this great, great stadium. And all of you who are watching through the miracle of satellite, stand to your feet too, and let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, tonight we have looked at this exciting, exciting prophecy of Daniel. Down through the ages, down through time, You have continued to control the nations of this world. And it is with the confidence of looking back that tonight we look forward, assured that Jesus will come soon. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Jesus, for the assurance of salvation and the assurance of an earth made new. And now tonight, as we go home, please protect us. Bring us back tomorrow night for another look into Your great word. We pray in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Amen. Thank you for being here tonight. Tomorrow night is Judgment Day approaching. Have you ever been afraid to face the judgment? I can tell you that tomorrow night, by this time, you will look forward to God's judgment day. Good night. God bless. We'll see you then.